Welcome to lecture 4 in this series on web-based technologies and multimedia applications. Today we will be discussing different ways of connecting to internet. The objective of today's discussion is to dwell into some very important ways of connecting to internet, as well as discuss those ways which are not very much popular but still prevalent in some countries due to the infrastructure that is existing in those countries. So, country to country, the way you connect to internet may change based on their domestic infrastructure. And even in a single country, it is often possible that in some area, always people prefer a particular way of connecting to internet when compared to another area. So, it all depends on the geography and the topography. So, we all need access to the internet. And this may be either from a dial-up connection or a direct line, such as using a coaxial cable, a fiber optic cable or copper wires, or using Wi-Fi, which I use at home as well as in the office, then by satellite or by cell phone or to say mobile phone. So, whatever I mentioned earlier, long back, maybe few decades back, I used to access internet using the dial-up connection. At that time, I had a phone, a landline. From there is a connection to the computer and we use a modem. So, when I am accessing internet, I cannot use my telephone. And the charges are that it is as if I am using my phone while speaking to somebody. So, my bills used to be the charges for calls but not on the internet usage. Later, I started using the Wi-Fi. Now, I am using Wi-Fi but using a FTTH, that is fiber to the home, and in office also I use Wi-Fi, and whenever I go out, I use the mobile phone's internet connection by using the mobile data. So, an individual himself is using different ways to connect to internet, but then there are many other ways to access internet. So, we will be discussing each of them. Initially, the two primary methods of accessing the internet were through a direct connection, allowing users of local area networks to go online through their school or workplace systems, and dial-up connections through a modem and a phone line. We will discuss these methods in detail. There are two popular ways of accessing the internet. One is wide broadband access, the other is wireless broadband access. So, the most important thing is wired and wireless. What are the advantages of wired and what are the advantages of wireless? Of course, the advantage of wireless is that you can just move with your device in a fixed range and your device will catch up the signal and you can access internet from your device. Wired, sit at one place, but a stable connection. Wireless, the connection may not be stable due to some blockades or some locations where you have some hurdles and signal cannot really reach your device. So, wide broadband is perfect, wireless is perfect, provided we do not have many hurdles. So, these are the two popular ways. One is wide broadband access, the other is wireless broadband access. Now, let us initially see what are the different ways of connecting to internet in the case of wired broadband access. So, in this there are number of ways, but let us discuss some important ones. For example, we have dial-up access, then ISDN, which stands for Integrated Services Digital Network, then we have leased lines, then we have cable internet access, and then we have fiber to the home. So, these are the some of the famous ways of connecting using wide broadband. Now, wireless broadband, there are three popular ways. They are satellite broadband, mobile broadband, and wireless ISP. Now, let us start with the wide broadband direct connection. Basically, this is a permanent connection which can be set up over a high speed communication link. This is normally used in organizations and corporates and use cable modem. that is used for the cable internet also, and a DSL connected to the internet. This kind of connection is established between your LAN server and the internet host or server. You may request for a connection as and when desired from your LAN server. It may have a direct line or may dial the number of the internet server to establish a link. One famous thing is that whenever you are using this type of connection, your internet service provider will also provide you with the number on which you have to dial to get the internet connection. Sometimes you will not get the line. So, you have to wait, you have to again dial, you have to dial again, and at some point you will get it, and once you get it, you would not like to disconnect because you don't know whether the call again gets connected or not. So, this is a major headache, and in initial days when internet access started, this is how we used to access the internet. In current years, high speed connections have gained popularity. These include cable, digital subscriber lines, usually known as DSL, and integrated services digital network. This dedicated high speed connection is best suited for larger organizations which have to serve many internal and external customers. This kind of link allows us to become information provider around the clock. This connection allows full connectivity to internet. However, because of organization's own security, privacy or policy reasons, we may choose not to use all the connectivity features. Now, let us see the dial-up connection. Dial-up connection, it is the most common form of connectivity because all it requires is that the users have a phone line, which almost everybody is having. However, they rely on phone lines, and since they have limited transmission capacity, dial-up modems are very slow. In addition, for dial-up connection to the internet, we need to have a computer account on an ISP. For using the account, you must provide the host machine with the username and password. Initially, some broadband services are started by BSNL and MTNL in India. The broadband connection offers more exciting multimedia applications through the internet, such as audio, video, dynamic animation, and other things. The difference between these high speed connections and dial-up modems does not lie only in the amount of information that is transportable via the connection, but unlike dial-up connections, these methods of connectivity do not tie up phone lines or other vital services. As a result, users are able to keep them connected at all times without tying up their phone. Now, let us see the process of setting up the internet connection. First of all, let us see how to set up the computer so that we can connect to internet using the dial-up internet connection. Let us assume that we are using Windows. Windows is having internet connection wizard. For example, let us consider a home user who wishes to use a dial-up connection through telephone line. Let's have a look at the steps to connect to internet using the wizard. First step is to open the start menu and select the control panel. Step 2 is, when control panel window is opened, choose the network and internet connection icon. The third step is new connection. Step 5 is that we have to click on create a new connection. Because in the new connection wizard, this particular thing will be visible. Hence, it is step 5, not a step 4, though we used the same phrase there. And to continue, we have to click the next button. Step 6 is, connection wizard will ask you the network connection types which you want to choose. As we are assuming an example of a home user who wishes to use a dial-up connection through telephone line, we will choose connected to the internet option. The next step is that we will assume that we know the internet service provider and we do not have any CD for installing automatically. Hence, we select set up my connection manually option. And then the next step says that we are using a dial-up modem. Hence, we have to select the appropriate option from the given options. So, we will be entering the name of internet service provider in the ISP box. And then we have to enter the telephone number with STD code given by the internet service provider for the dial-up connection to internet in the text box phone number. Once we do that, we will be entering our username and password into the provided boxes, and then we will click the next button to continue. We must confirm our password in the confirm password box. Then we have to click the checkbox to add a shortcut to this connection to the desktop, and then click the finish button. So once we have done that, we are through almost. Then after completing the new connection wizard, we can check whether the dial-up connection icon has appeared in network connection window or not. To open the properties of dial-up connection that where we named internet service provider, we have to right click the icon of the ISP. Then we can check and make the setting of this dial-up connection according to our need, like we can adjust security parameters according to our needs. In addition, there are some networking and advanced options available which we can try. So first thing is we need to have a telephone line, okay? And the CD that is given by the operator is run, and it sets up the internet on our computer, and we have to dial the numbers that are given by the internet service provider. Normally they are given on the CD. Sometimes the numbers themselves fill the box. So we have to dial. If that number is busy, we will not be able to connect. And this is how people used to access internet initially when it is available in India. Then let us see what is this ISDN. ISDN means it is Integrated Services Digital Network. It is a switched telephone service capable of transporting voice and digital data, and is one of the oldest internet access methods. ISDN has been used for voice, video conferencing and broadband data applications. ISDN was very popular in Europe but less common in North America. In India also it is very popular. Its use peaked in the late 1990s before the availability of DSL and cable modem technologies. Basic rate ISDN, known as ISDN BRI, has 264 kilobits or bearer or B channels. These channels can be used separately for voice or data calls or bonded together to provide a 128 kilobits service. Multiple ISDN BRI lines can be bonded together to provide data rates above 128 kilobits. Primary rate ISDN, known as ISDN PRI, has 23 bearer channels, that is 64 kilobits per second each, for a combined data rate of 1.5 megabits per second. An ISDN E1, that is European standard line, has 30 bearer channels and a combined data rate of 1.9 megabits per second. So this is how ISDN works. Now there is something called leased lines. In many organizations, they have leased lines. Leased lines, normally they provide access to internet round the clock. So 24/7 you will have access to internet, and of course you will be accessing internet as and when you need, but that provision exists that you can access internet anytime. They are dedicated lines used primarily by internet service providers, business and other large enterprises to connect local area networks and campus networks to the internet using the existing infrastructure of the public telephone network or other providers. Delivered using wire, optical fiber and radio, leased lines are used to provide internet access directly, as well as the building blocks from which several other forms of internet access are created. T-Carrier is a member of the series of carrier systems developed by AT&T Bell Labs for digital transmission of multiplex telephone calls technology. It dates back to 1957 and provides data rates that range from 56 and 64 kilobits per second to 1.5 megabits per second. This is about the T1 line. And sometimes this 64 kilobits per second will also go to 45 megabits per second. This is the case of T3 line. So a T1 line carries 24 voice or data channels, so that customers may use some channels for data and others for voice traffic, or use all 24 channels for for clear channel data. A T3 line carries 28 T1 channels. Fractional T1 lines are also available in multiples of a DS0 to provide data rates between 56 and 1500 kilobits per second. T carrier lines require special termination equipment that may be separate from or integrated into a router or switch, and which may be purchased or leased from an ISP. In Japan, the equivalent standard is J1 by J3. In Europe, a slightly different standard, E-carrier, a member of the series of carrier systems developed for digital transmission of many simultaneous telephone calls by time division multiplexing, and provides 32 user channels at 64 kilobits per second on an E1, and 512 user channels or 16 E1s on an E3. Synchronous optical networking, in short we call it SONET, and synchronous digital hierarchy, in short we can call SDH, are the standard multiplexing protocols used to carry high data rate digital bit streams over optical fiber using lasers or highly coherent light from light emitting diodes. At lower transmission rates, data can also be transferred via an electrical interface. The basic unit of framing is an optical or electrical stream which carries 155.520 megabits per second. Higher data rates are delivered in multiples of 4 data streams with uniform bandwidth. The 1, 10, 40 and 100 gigabit Ethernet IEEE standards that fall under 802.3 allow digital data to be delivered over copper wiring at distances to 100 meters and over optical fiber at distances to 40 kilometers. Now let us see what is meant by the cable internet access. What happens is that the cable internet access infrastructure is same as that of the cable television. So you have cable TV, you have wire that is connected to your TV, and then you also have a set-top box. So the same infrastructure is used to access internet also. Like a digital subscriber line and fiber to the premises services, cable internet access providers provide network edge connectivity, that is last mile access from the internet service provider to an end user. It is integrated into the cable television infrastructure analogously to DSL, which uses the existing telephone network. Cable TV networks and telecommunications networks are the two predominant forms. Recently, both have seen increased competition from fiber deployments, wireless and mobile networks. Broadband cable internet access requires a cable modem at the customer's premises and a cable modem termination system, which in short we call CMTS, at the cable operator facility, typically a cable television head end. The two are connected via coaxial cable or a hybrid fiber coaxial plant. We call it in short as HFC. If the HFC network is large, the cable modem termination system can be grouped into hubs for efficient management. Downstream, the direction towards the user bit rates can be as high as 1 gigabits per second. Upstream traffic originating at the user ranges from 384 kilobits per second to more than 50 megabits per second. One downstream channel can handle hundreds of cable modems. As the system grows, the CMTS can be upgraded with more downstream and upstream ports and grouped into hub CMTS for efficient management. In the case of cable internet, bandwidth is shared among all the subscribers. So, cable internet access is also very much fine, and normally you will pay the price based on the bandwidth for which you subscribed. If you subscribe to the higher bandwidth, then you have to pay more. So this is how cable internet operates. Now let us see how DSL operates, that is a digital subscriber line. DSL service provides a connection to the internet through the telephone network. Unlike dial-up, DSL can operate using a single phone line without preventing normal use of the telephone line for voice phone calls. DSL uses the high frequencies, while the low audible frequencies of the line are left free for regular telephone connection. these frequency bands are subsequently separated by filters installed at the customer's premises. In ADSL, that is asymmetric DSL, the data throughput in the upstream direction is lower than that in the downstream direction, hence the designation of asymmetric. In the case of SDSL, that is symmetric DSL, both the data rates are same. Now let us see what is FTTH. FTTH stands for fiber to the home. It is the delivery of communication signal over optical fiber from the operator switching equipment all the way to your home, thereby replacing existing copper infrastructure such as telephone wires and coaxial cables. The use of optical fiber offers much higher data rates over relatively longer distances. Most high capacity internet and cable television backbones already use fiber optic technology, with data switched to other technologies such as DSL cable and others for final delivery to the customers. Now there is something called power line internet. See, one important thing is, initially when we are accessing internet, we are using the telephone line. We are connecting the telephone line to the computer, we have a modem, okay, and when we are accessing the internet, your telephone line is busy, so you are charged just as if you are using your phone. That is how we use it. So we are using telephone lines. Then we are using cable network to access the internet. Now we will see how to use the power lines. So you are getting power to your home. There are wires which are supplying power to your home, and using that infrastructure also it is possible to connect to internet or access the internet. This is called power line internet, and we also call it as a broadband over power lines. It carries data on a conductor that is used for electric power transmission. Because of the extensive power line infrastructure already in place, this technology can provide people in rural and low population areas access to the internet with little cost in terms of new transmission equipment, cables or wires. Data rates are asymmetric and generally range from 256 kilobits per second to 2.7 megabits per second. In this technology, a repeater needs to be installed on each transformer. So a repeater is nothing but a signal booster. See, the name repeater, repeat means you are again doing it. So you get the signal with the same strength or with increased strength, you forward it. So wherever you think that the signal will become weak, there you install one signal booster or repeater. So it will again transmit the signal with the same strength or with a higher strength. So one disadvantage with power lines is that wherever there is a transformer, we need to have a repeater there. So you have more transformers, you need more repeaters. You have less transformers, you need less repeaters. So data rates, they are asymmetric and generally range from 256 kilobits per second to 2.7 megabits per second. In rural areas, due to low population, suppose the transmission equipment is less, then it is even difficult to offer internet access to those areas. But one thing is important, wherever there is access to the power, it is possible to provide access to internet using this concept of power line internet. In this technology, the only thing is that we need to install signal boosters or repeaters on each transformer. There is another thing called satellite broadband. This is also under wireless broadband access. Basically, until now we have seen wired broadband access. Now we will see wireless broadband access. In this, the first one which we will be looking into is satellite broadband. Satellite broadband internet provides fixed, portable and mobile internet access. Data rates range from 2 kilobits per second to 1 gigabit per second downstream, and from 1-2 kilobits per second to 10 megabits per second upstream. In the northern hemisphere, satellite antenna dishes require a clear line of sight to the southern sky due to the equatorial position of all geostationary satellites. Northern hemisphere means half of the earth, that is north of the equator. In the southern hemisphere, the situation is reversed and dishes are pointed north. Service can be adversely affected by moisture, rain and snow, and it is also known as rain fade. the system requires a carefully aimed directional antenna. Another wireless internet access method is mobile broadband, and this is what most of us are using already. Mobile broadband, or we can also call it as a wireless internet access, it is delivered through mobile phone towers to computers, mobile phones and other digital devices using portable modems. Some mobile services allow more than one device to be connected to the internet using a single cellular connection using a process called tethering. The modem may be built into laptop computers, tablets, mobile phones and other devices, added to some devices using PC cards, USB modems and USB sticks or dongles, or separate wireless modems can be used. So by using all these things, we can access the mobile broadband. So there are different ways with which we can connect to internet using wide access. There are different ways of connecting to internet using wireless access. What I suggest to you is that try to find out some ways of accessing internet which are not covered in today's discussion. And in case you have any doubts or questions, please feel free to email to me. I have also given you some references. Thank you very much for joining.